Hello, everybody. I'm so glad to have you join us online. You know, we had spent a massive amount of time planning a six-week journey for the entire church, but we have laid that aside for another time. I have titled this sermon series, Standing Strong, and I want to share my heart along with our teaching team on how to face uncertain times, not with fear and anxiety, but with courage and hope. So for the next 6 weeks, here's our goal. We're going to strive to love God more faithfully, to follow God more trustfully, and to listen to God more mindfully. I'll be setting up the series with some foundational teaching today, and then each week for the next 6 weeks, we will take a look at a biblical character and learn some deep lessons on standing strong with courage and hope. So I can't wait to get into the message today, but I do want to take a moment to remind you that at the end of the service today, I'm going to invite us to take communion together. So if you have a piece of bread or cracker and some juice, water is fine as well. If you could keep those items within reach at this time, that'll be great. We'll do this at the end. So I want to start by reading some passages about our God, in whose name we have gathered. Hey, I know we did this throughout the Luke series, but I'm going to ask, before I read these words, if you're able to, would you just stand with me at this time as we read these words together, these amazing words from Scripture. And then as you stand, just go ahead and take a deep breath. Just take a deep breath. Maybe this is the first time you did this today. Just take a deep breath and go, you know what? I'm breathing in faith. I'm breathing out fear. I'm breathing in hope. I'm breathing out worry. I'm breathing in the knowledge that my God loves me. I'm breathing out anxious thoughts. Take a deep breath. And as I read these words, just breathe these words in. Let these words just sink into your mind, into your heart, into your soul. This is what the Bible claims. Exodus 34:6, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth. 1 Chronicles 16:34, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Psalm 33:5, the earth is full of the goodness of the Lord. Psalm 145, verses 5 to 7. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. The might of your awesome deeds shall be proclaimed, and I will declare your greatness. They shall celebrate the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. John 8:12, Jesus spoke to them, saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Matthew 5:14, you are the light of the world, Jesus says. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. Thank you. You may be seated. Actually, let me pray, and then we'll dive in. Dear Father, your word declares you are good. The earth is full of the goodness of our God. And we come humbly before you in these difficult times, or when we see such drastic and sudden change all around us, and our minds just race with concerns, our hearts become weary and heavy for those that are suffering. Yet we are so grateful that we have your word to guide us. We are so grateful, God, that we can bring these concerns to you in prayer. And so, Father, I pray your Spirit will enter into the depths of our souls, into the depths of our worry, and bring peace. Help us to stand strong in our faith with our eyes fixed on you, with our eyes focused on you, with our eyes set on you. Use this time we have together to deepen our bonds of community, even in these times of separation. May each person listening to this sermon, I pray that they would hear your voice above mine. So we ask all of these things in the good and precious and mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. The church said, amen, amen, amen. You know, when I was at Eastern University in the mid-90s, I wrote a paper on change. I actually got fascinated by the topic. I still am. And I love to read about how people and institutions and nations change and deal with change. And as I was preparing this message this last week, I remembered that paper because I started that paper with a quote. And it was by a pre-Socratic Greek philosopher named Heraclitus. Now, Heraclitus, this Greek philosopher, he lived some 2,500 years ago, and he was fascinated with this idea of change in our world. And he actually wrote quite a bit about change. So here are some things he said about change. He said this: all is flux. Nothing stays still. Nothing endures but change. There is nothing permanent except change. This is what Heraclitus wrote 2,500 years ago. So this week, my mind went back to the paper I wrote some 24 years ago because, boy, are we seeing change at such a rapid pace, aren't we? An invisible enemy creating havoc in our world. Millions of people are being laid off at work. Dramatic slowdown in the economy. Panic among people. Sporting events and concerts are being canceled. Schools are closed. Travel bans all across the globe. Grocery stores running out of toilet paper. Sudden, frightening, drastic change is everywhere, and uncertainty, it seems, has taken a lease next door and set up shop. So this week, you know, I did a search on Google and on what are some of the cover stories on some of the most read magazines in our country. And I found some interesting covers that I want to share with you. You'll see them on the screen. You know, the Time magazine cover story just says coronavirus. And if you read that article, it's a very stark picture of what's happening in our world. Scientific American magazine cover story is titled Anatomy of an Outbreak. And the subtitle tries to answer this question: are we ready to face the new coronavirus? The short answer is no, we are not. Fortune magazine has a cover story titled A Planet in Crisis. That's pretty self-explanatory. Business Week magazine has already dubbed 2020 as the lost year. That was their cover story, the lost year. Because in terms of profits and revenues and GDP and productivity, Business Week is already calling 2020 the lost year. And then my favorite, New York magazine has a cover story that says, don't panic, with the word don't struck out. Can we panic now? As I was thinking of the paper I wrote back in the mid-90s, my mind started going back, you know, over just a tremendous amount of things that has changed in our world since the time I wrote that paper. You know, back when I was writing that paper at Eastern, there was no iPod, no iPhone, no iPad. There was no Wikipedia, no Facebook, no YouTube, no Twitter. There were no smartphones, no iTunes, and BlackBerry was simply a summer fruit. Back then, there were no Blu-rays, you couldn't download books on Kindle from the air, and no one used words like staycation, blogs, or XHTML. Talking about the 90s, those of you who are old enough to remember, do you remember the time when you had to develop film rolls for photos, or clean the head of your VHS player, or keep track of your floppy disks? Which kind of sounds awful now, right? Did you bring your floppy disk? Yeah, I have my floppy disk. It sounds like a back problem. Back in the 90s, Pluto used to be a planet. It's no longer a planet, it's a dwarf planet. I'm still pretty upset about that. I miss Pluto. Change, it seems, is everywhere. Sometimes change involves good news, and sometimes change involves pain and loss. Sometimes you like change, and sometimes you don't like change. And we are getting a steady, full and constant dose of change that is painful. So the question in front of us is, how do you deal with change and uncertainty as God's people? How do we deal with change and uncertainty? Especially when they are this drastic and this sudden and this frightening and this painful. Where do you go to find hope and courage? Now, if you read the biblical narrative, you will find that in the midst of great change, God often takes a moment to remind his people of certain things. I mean, there's this recurring pattern in the Bible. I was just going through this week. The Israelites cross the Red Sea, and God tells Moses to gather his people and remind them of certain things. When Joshua is old, and just before he dies, he gathers all the leaders and he reminds them of certain things. Things go south, and God sends the prophets to remind his people of certain things. When Jesus appeared, he was constantly reminding people about another reality. He insisted that from Moses to the prophets, the central theme that binds all of Scripture was to be found in him. The story continues in the book of Acts and the rest of the New Testament, and now it's us. So I was thinking about this, and as we are facing great change and uncertainty in our time, what might God's reminders to us be for the next chapter of our story? So I want to do what God has done with his people for thousands of years in the unfolding God story of Scripture. So let's gather around, and I'm going to remind us all of some pivotal truths. You know, God knows this is how we stand strong with hope and courage in times of uncertainty and change. We need remembering. We need remembering. You know, I started by quoting Heraclitus, that there is nothing permanent except change. I think Heraclitus didn't quite get it fully right, because there are some things that are permanent. They will never be in flux, they will never change, and they will endure. Among other things, I want us to consider four things that haven't changed. These are things you can always count on, always rely on, always know them to be true. These are the reminders for God's people in our time. This is where you will find your courage and hope and be able to stand strong no matter what. Here's the first one. Our God is still good all the time. All the time, our God is still good. You know, I started a time by reading just some of the passages in Scripture that claims repeatedly that our God is good. He is wise. He's sovereign. He's holy. He's righteous. He's awesome. He's powerful. He's faithful. All the time. He doesn't change. You can bank on this truth. Now, the same God, he extends his goodness and mercy and compassion and love to everyone who turns to him. You know, sometimes people think of all the things that they have done, the anger they contain, the hurt they have inflicted, the sins in their lives, the damaging words they have spoken, the relationships they have destroyed, and they think, man, I've gone so far away from this God of awesome power and amazing goodness. God can never love me. That is simply not true. The Bible declares that this unbelievably powerful and good God with limitless power, this God who created the universe, the galaxies, the solar system, and earth, this same God is totally in love with you. One day, God thought it would be a great thing, it's a great idea, that there should be a you on planet Earth. No matter what is happening around you and to you, you are God's idea. He created you, he knew you before you were born, and he longs to fellowship with you. God loves you, and there is no reason for his love. His love just is. You know, Augustine once wrote, God loves each of us as if there was only one of us, and there is nothing that we can do. Interesting point here. God doesn't wait for you to clean up your act, to get some achievements under your belt, to measure up to some imaginary standards. God doesn't love you because of your success. He doesn't love you because of your intellect. He doesn't love you because of your personality or your possessions or your achievements. God loves you, and there's nothing you can do about it. You didn't merit it. You don't deserve it. You can't earn it. You can't buy it. It just is. It's just grace. All you have to do is to receive it by faith. God is good. And his mercies are new every morning. If you trust in him, then everything you really need, his hand will provide. Everything you really, really need, his hand will provide. I think our God would remind us that you can draw tremendous courage and hope in uncertain and difficult times from knowing that our God is good all the time. All the time, our God is still good. And that he is faithful, that he is trustworthy, and he has lost none of his power. That has not changed. Here's another thing that has not changed. Jesus Christ is still Lord, and he is still Savior. Jesus Christ is still Lord, and he's still Savior. Somebody say an amen. Man, I just miss us not being here together. In fact, if you're watching this, you know, I can all, you know, hear Paul and Tom and William yelling an amen. If you're watching this, And, you know, just turn to the person next to you and just say amen. If you're watching this alone, just look heavenward and say amen. And if you're watching this online and you're following along in the chat, just drop a word in the chat section right now and say amen. If you believe Jesus Christ is still Lord and still Savior, just drop an amen. That will never change. See, politicians come and go. Nations rise and fall. Civilizations form and vanish. But Jesus Christ remains the hope of the world. See, Hebrews 13:8 tells us, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. And because Jesus died and rose again, you and I have the hope of an ongoing eternal relationship with God. Because of Jesus, nothing can separate you and me from the love of God. And if you have never taken the step of making a full surrender of your life to Jesus, man, I wish you would do that today. I wish you would do that today. Our hope is not built on institutions. Our hope is not built on the stock market. Our hope is not built on accomplishments or careers or a company. Our hope is built on the one who's the same yesterday and today and forever. That's the one hope we offer. It's Jesus. He's our Lord. He's our Savior. He's our leader. He's our friend. He's our master. He's our King. He is our hope. Apart from Jesus, we can offer nothing. He is the hope of the world, and that remains unchanged. You just think of all the odds and persecution and trials the followers of Jesus Christ have gone through over the last 2,000 years. You think of state-sanctioned persecution. You think about people losing their homes, their freedom, their possessions, their very lives for Jesus. You think about Christ followers losing their financial security, their health, facing hardships. The one thing that has held us together for thousands of years is this, that Jesus is still Lord and He is still Savior. That Jesus died and rose again. That we have the assurance of one day living with Him forever, where there will be no more tears and no more pain and no more sickness and no more disease and no more death. You take away this hope, and what have you got? You got nothing. I think our God would remind us in these difficult times that upon the reality of this awful virus and terrible economic news and sadness and suffering, there's another and greater reality, the fact that this awesome love story of God sending His Son Jesus for us, entering into our suffering, even unto death, and then being resurrected for our hope. And therefore, we can now have faith. We now have courage. We now have hope. Faith that is unwavering, courage that is unchanging, and hope that is undying. Here's one more thing that has not changed. God's word is still true. God's word is still true, and it is still living, and it is still active, and it is still sharp, and it is still powerful. You know, so many people are facing loss and suffering and heartbreak, and I believe the Bible can and does speak with authority in these times and these kind of situations. It speaks eternal truths into the hearts and souls of humanity. When someone is suffering from COVID-19, when someone is facing financial ruin, when someone is dying, the Word of God says, even if you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you will fear no evil. Your God is with you. You want courage and hope in these times? God's Word is perfect. It revives the soul. You want guidance in the storm, in the uncertainty? God's word is trustworthy, making wise the simple. You want light in the darkness? God's word is a lamp unto your feet. It will light your path. It is the story that gives your story meaning and purpose. It is worth your time to read it. You know, people tell me sometimes, reading the Bible is hard. Reading the Bible is hard. When was the last time you did something that was profoundly worthwhile and meaningful and personally transforming and it was easy? Where do you read in the Bible that God comes to someone and says, here's a worthwhile task that you can give your life to, and by the way, it is going to be easy? I think our God would remind us that you can draw tremendous courage and hope in uncertain and difficult times from reading His word. Read it first thing in the morning before you reach for anything else. Download the YouVersion app. Play it on your smartphone. Read it, study it, learn from it. But most important thing of all, do what it tells you to do. Do what it tells you to do. Don't let your life be driven by your wants. Don't let your life be driven by your desires. Don't let your life be driven by your circumstances. Let your life be driven by the Word of God. By the Word of God. I'll tell you something else. This book tells us that one day Jesus is coming back, and on that day all will be well. This book tells us that sin and death will be defeated, and our world and all of creation will not only be set right and redeemed, it will be spectacularly redeemed. God's word is still true and living and active. And in these times, if you anchor yourself in it, you will find all the hope and courage you need to go through this season of your life. Here's one last thing that hasn't changed. The church of Jesus Christ is still marching on. The church of Jesus Christ is still marching on. In these days, when most of the world's population are on a stay-at-home order, we join our brothers and sisters around the globe to proclaim the death and resurrection of our Lord. That there is hope, that there is a light in the darkness, that there is a purpose to life. It is in this environment that we reimagine our calling to a priestly vocation as the Church of Jesus Christ. The church, us, we've been built upon the sturdy foundation of the chief cornerstone of Jesus himself to weather all and any storms that come our way. In a world where there are so many things that have gone wrong, in a society with people bent and broken and dying, the church is the intense and bright light in a very dark time, drawing blinded persons into the light of Jesus. Just as Christians were scattered throughout the catacombs of a hostile Rome, we are now the scattered lifeblood of Jesus, sprinkled throughout our world, bringing life and courage and hope in every possible way. We listen to the word being proclaimed, the truth being preached, Christ being lifted up, and the reminders from God about our common story. This makes us dangerous. This makes God's people dangerous. This makes you and me, Damascus Road, dangerous. Because they create hope that requires that present social arrangements be seen through prophetic lens. In the midst of fear and anxiety, we are able to see the world as it really is, with another reality at play in which the healing power of our Lord Jesus Christ is at work. Jesus said, "He is the light of the world." He also said, "Because of him, we are the light of the world," which is why our goal is to be a community of light by the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, several weeks ago, when the coronavirus was first making the news, while we were still able to meet, I actually did a devotion with our staff based on Luke 21. You know, as we were doing a journey through Luke, I did a devotion with our staff on Luke 21, where Jesus talks about some terrible things that are going to happen. You know, natural disasters, man-made crises, you know, famines and earthquakes and pestilences and wars and persecution. There will be a season of fear and anxiety. Times are going to be tough, Jesus says. And Jesus tells his disciples, you know, I talked to our staff about this. He tells them, watch and pray and take precautions. And he tells them to be alert. And he tells them something else that is so relevant to us today. When bad things are happening all around you, Jesus says to them in Luke 21:13, he says, this will give you an opportunity to testify. This is brilliant. This will give you an opportunity to testify. The tragedy that you see around you, Jesus says, is also an opportunity for you to testify, to be a witness for Jesus. When the world is panicking and anxious and running out of options, the followers of Jesus Christ are to testify to a hope that goes beyond all fears and all anxiety, even death. You know, I just read an article, you know, how this pandemic is already leading to the dawn of what could be the fourth great spiritual awakening here in America. Now, those of you who've read the history of Christianity in America, you know about the three great spiritual awakenings. There are some people that are saying that we might be on the threshold of the fourth great spiritual awakening. You know, I so miss our gatherings together here, but we are seeing a huge jump in new folks joining us online. Do you know that we've had over 5,000 unique viewings? Not viewers, unique viewings. You know, if you're watching this with your family, all of you are considered one unique viewing. So many of these viewings have multiple people watching. We've had over 41,000 impressions on YouTube. By the way, if each of you watching can subscribe to the Damascus Road YouTube channel, it's going to actually help us unlock some features that'll be of great benefit to our tech team. So everybody watching this, if you could just subscribe, that would be of great help to us. There's no cost for this. So just, you know, if you're part of Damascus Road family, you need to subscribe to our YouTube channel. If you're new or if you've been following us, if you could subscribe to our YouTube channel, we would greatly appreciate it. There's actually no cost to this, but it will give us an opportunity to testify. Do you know, over 1,000 masks have been made and donated by our church members. Countless boxes of food, groceries, meals to healthcare workers, trunk loads of clothing for the homeless in Baltimore. At-risk kids getting activity kits to engage them in positive activities. Coming alongside Title I schools, the recovery community, and partner churches on four continents. These are just some of the things that are happening through the generosity of our church. Additionally, many are calling, emailing, and praying with people. And Jesus said, listen, when bad things happen, this is going to be an opportunity for the church to testify. This is going to be an opportunity for Damascus Road Community Church to testify. Millions are searching for meaning and answers. You know, YouVersion just reported that millions more are asking for prayers online. In just the last month, you know, their online prayer requests just went up by millions more. Online searches for peace and hope have skyrocketed. And Jesus says, listen, when these kind of things happen around you, this is going to be an opportunity for you to testify. When things get hard, make sure you're asking the right questions. What is the opportunity here? Who can I help? Who can I share Jesus with? Who needs hope? Who needs courage? Who needs to have more faith? You have it in Jesus. If you know Jesus as Lord and Savior, you need to share it. That's what Jesus would remind us to do. He reminds us this is an opportunity for you and me to testify. See, this virus is contagious. I'm hoping that people in Damascus Road Community Church are even more contagious with the hope and courage we have in Jesus. That's my hope. That we, the people of God, become even more contagious in this season. See, here's the thing. Jerusalem did fall. The temple did get destroyed. Terrible, awful things did happen to many of those early Christians. Homes were destroyed. The city of Jerusalem was destroyed. The nation was destroyed. But then they remembered what Jesus said. And the worst tragedy, Christians being scattered all over the place, became an opportunity. And the good news of Jesus began to spread all over. Please understand, God cannot do evil, but he can redeem it for good. He can work all things for good for those who love him. That's something you and I can always count on. We may be scattered, but we belong to him. And when we place our trust and our hope in him, we look at what is happening all around us, and we, the church, remember what the church has always remembered throughout church history. In difficult times, the worst tragedies can be the best opportunities to testify because people are looking for hope and courage. I want to leave you with a picture of what this looks like in our world today. Back in 2004, the country of Ukraine was in a bitter election. Although poll after poll showed that Viktor Yushchenko was leading by 10%, after the election, the official government result, which was marked by widespread fraud, sent to the media, declared that he had lost to his Russia-backed rival. The state-run television station was given a script to read. The news anchor read, "Ladies and gentlemen, we announce that the challenger Viktor Yushchenko has been decisively defeated." That was false, but that's what the news anchors, were given to read. But the government officials forgot one small detail. Ukrainian state-run television news featured a small picture-in-picture at the bottom of the screen where a sign language interpreter provides translation for the hearing impaired. So on that day, November 24, 2004, as the news anchor started reading what the government officials provided them to read, everyone in the newsroom knew what they were broadcasting was false and lies. Natalia Dimitruk was the sign language interpreter that day. As the news anchor started reading the false reports, Natalia quietly deviated from the script. She just couldn't bring herself to interpret the false news, the lies. So right there in the corner of the screen, in the corner of the screen, she started signing to the deaf community, and this is what she said. "I'm addressing everyone who's deaf in Ukraine. Our president is Viktor Yushchenko. Do not trust the results of the Central Election Committee. They are all lies. and I'm very ashamed to translate such lies to you. Maybe you will see me again. She knew she was doing this at great risk. But that little spark of courage led the deaf community to get the word out. They text messaged their friends on cell phones about the fraudulent elections. News got out to other journalists who took courage from Natalia's act of defiance and likewise refused to broadcast the party line. Within a few weeks, a million people wearing orange flooded the capital city of Kiev and demanded new elections. It led to the Orange Revolution in Ukraine, and the situation ended up in the Ukrainian Supreme Court, which declared the election invalid, and a new election was held where Yushchenko emerged as the undisputed winner. It all started with this one simple woman in a picture inside the picture telling the truth. See, we cannot control what the big screen is telling people all around us, all the messages of fear and anxiety and all kinds of awful stuff. But we are that little picture inset. And our job is to tell people what we often hear in the big screen isn't the whole story or even the real story. We are like Natalia, a simple sign language interpreter telling people, don't always believe what you see in the big screen. There is a king. He's a good and righteous king. He's above all other kings. And there is a kingdom that will never end. And that ultimately there's a day coming when all things will be made right. See, we have the message of true and abiding peace. We have the message of true and abiding hope. We have the message of true and abiding courage. And because he lives, we can face all our tomorrows. The church of Jesus Christ is marching on, and that has not changed. Courage and hope come from remembering. So as we go through these uncertain times, we draw courage from what is certain, what hasn't changed. Our God, he's still good all the time. All the time, our God is still good. Jesus Christ is still Lord and still Savior. The Word of God is still true. And the Church of Jesus Christ is still marching on. So I requested our worship team to sing this hymn as our closing song. And this hymn has a lot of personal meaning for me. I grew up in a church where we used to sing this hymn a lot. And whenever there would be a tragedy or crazy things would happen around us or even inside the church community, the pastors and the elders would just gather the church together and we would sing this hymn. So listen to these words. Sing along if you know it. And I want to also encourage you to use this time for reflection, you know, prayer, confession, praise. You know, wherever the Holy Spirit leads your heart, just take this moment and just do whatever the Spirit is telling you to do. I'm also going to ask us all to get ready for communion. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, I want to invite you to the Lord's table. So if you can have the bread and cracker and juice or water ready at this time, after we sing the song together or listen to the song together, I'm going to come back and we're going to do communion together. His faithfulness. And so we come together in this meal. You know, sharing in this meal is an act of covenant and commitment to our Lord and to each other as the church of Jesus Christ. It is to commit to share in the mission of our Lord. It is a demonstration that heaven has now come down here on earth, that the gift of life is now eternal through the resurrected Christ, that God has called us to live in reconciled humanity forever and ever, that this meal is both at the center of our shared ministry and calling and also the fuel for it. So as you hold on to the elements, remember that the piece of bread signifies the broken body of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the juice or water signifies the blood Jesus shed for us. See, courage and hope come from remembering. Courage and hope come from remembering. So we remember that on the night Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to them. He gives it to us, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." If you believe that, I invite you to take the bread. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." This is the new covenant, that Jesus Christ was crucified for our sins, but he was resurrected for our hope. If you believe that, I invite you to take the cup. Amen. Hey, if you're new, please let us know in the chat section. And if you would like somebody to pray for you, we would love to do that. We have prayer ministers that are willing and able, and they look forward to praying with you and for you. And you can just drop us a note at prayforme@damascus.com. We'd love to have an opportunity to pray for you. Let's pray. Dear Father, I'm so grateful that with all the restrictions in place, we were still able to meet this way today. I'm even more grateful that there are some truths that remain unchanged. God, you're still good all the time. All the time, you're still good. Jesus, you're still Lord. You're still Savior. The Word of God is still true, still so powerful, so sharp, so living, and so active, that the Church of Jesus Christ is still marching on. Additionally, grace still beats sin, prayers still get heard, heaven's mercies are still new every morning, the cross still testifies to the power of sacrificial love, the tomb is still empty, and Jesus is still planning on coming back to set all creation right. Lord, on those things we bank our trust. Father, I pray that you will bless our goal in these 6 weeks to love you more faithfully, to follow you more trustfully, and to listen to you more mindfully. I also pray that you will help each of us to live the truth of your words, that when terrible things happen all around us, this will be an opportunity for us to testify about you. We can do that because you took the worst tragedy of Good Friday and you made it into the greatest opportunity of Easter Sunday for us. And when our days are dark and hopeless and our hearts are discouraged and our minds are confused, please remind us of these great truths we talked about today and those beautiful words. This is an opportunity for us to testify. We ask these things, Father, in the powerful and matchless name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 We hope to see you again next week. In the meantime, during the week, you can join us for our Wednesday night prayer meeting. God bless you.
Thank you for joining us online.